All right. Welcome, everyone, to the 2022 Champions of Change Conference. Change to Advance Equity for... To Advance Equity for All, hosted by the Howard County Department of Community Resources and Services. My name is Mackenzie Lawings. I'm a 17-year-old senior at the illustrious Wild Lake High School.
Hello, all. How are y'all tonight? My name is Samaya Miles. I am also a 17-year-old senior at the illustrious Wild Lake High School. Tonight and tomorrow, if you happen to be here, me and Mackenzie will be your MCs. And we are so excited to be here. Thank you guys so much for showing up. To begin, we would just like to thank Howard County Library System and Columbia Community Cares for sponsoring this. Events like these are so important, and you guys do not understand how much this means. To begin, I would like to introduce Ms. Erica Strauss-Chavarria, the Executive Director of Columbia Community Care. Erica Strauss-Chavarria is originally from Albuquerque, New Mexico. She obtained a BS in political science and Latin American studies from the University of Pittsburgh in 2004. She went on to obtain a master's degree in international law and human rights from the Nation University for Peace in Costa Rica. After receiving her master's in teaching from Towson, she returned to her alma mater, Wild Lake High School, to teach. Erica is an advocate for racial and social justice. She became a practitioner and trainer of restorative justice in efforts to end the school-to-prison pipeline. She has presented multiple times across the country on topics related to racial justice in education, anti-racism, and restorative justice. Now, Erica founded and is now the full-time director, executive director of Columbia Community Care, an organization that has provided hundreds of thousands of people in her community with groceries and supplies during the pandemic. Columbia Community Care has received so many awards, including Howard County Best Volunteer Organization in 2020, 2021, and 2022. Also, Erica is a recipient of the 2020 Howard County Human Rights Commission Human Rights Award. Please give it up for Erica Strauss-Chavarria.
Thank you so much, Mackenzie and Samaya. Aren't they amazing? That is Wild Lake High School, I would just like to say. Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us for this reception and keynote address. My name is Erica Chavarria, former Wild Lake High School Spanish teacher for 12 years, currently serving as executive director of Columbia Community Care. I founded Columbia Community Care in response to the food needs of my students and their families when schools shut down in March of 2020 due to the pandemic. And many of those volunteers and my board are here today, my site coordinators. If you are one of them or if you've ever volunteered, can you just raise your hand? Let's give everybody a round of applause. Thank you. Although Howard County is considered one of the wealthiest counties in the state and country, we are not immune to poverty or hunger by any means. And this was highlighted even more when CCC saw thousands of Howard County residents waiting in lines for food at our 5 in-person distribution sites and thousands more submitting applications for our delivery service. At CCC, we see firsthand the impact of joblessness, low wages, systemic racism, and systemic inequities. We know that there is a higher concentration of hunger and poverty in communities of color and immigrant communities, not just here in Howard County, but nationwide. CCC has exposed the need that many of us already knew existed in our community, but no one in Howard County could ignore or unsee the truth after driving past one of our sites. From the beginning, CCC has been intentional about removing barriers to access. We do not require identification or proof of need, which is such a dehumanizing and humiliating process. Our sites are located within walking distance from many families, and we have a free delivery service for those who are unable to get to our sites due to lack of transportation or for any other reason. Over the last almost 3 years, CCC has grown to almost 9,000 Facebook members, 8 in-person site coordinators, 2 delivery pantry coordinators, hundreds of volunteers monthly, including dozens of community organizations and community partners, and thousands of consistent donors. CCC has served over 150,000 residents in Howard County and has completed over 15,000 grocery deliveries. And although it seems like a number that we want to applaud, I do not see that as a success. I see that as a humongous failure. Although appreciating all of the work that goes into doing that work. We currently operate at 3 in-person distribution sites on Saturdays from 10 to 12, and our delivery service operates out of our headquarters, the Columbia Flyer Building. Columbia Community Care has done an incredible job at providing essential resources to our community for almost 3 years now. However, we know that we must focus on the system and institutions that create the injustice and inequities that exist for so many of our families across Howard County. The system thrives on the existence of the few having an abundance and the majority having nothing. And the system is doing exactly what it was designed to do, as we so learned today in our pre-conference. As a 501c3 nonprofit, Columbia Community Care is committed to addressing the holistic needs of Howard County families and keeping our values of restorative justice, liberation and freedom, healing and peace, joy, community care and mutual aid, human dignity and collective power at the forefront of our actions. The mission of Columbia Community Care is to provide resources, services and programs to students and families in Howard County under 4 pillars: liberation education, health and healing, purpose pathways, and essential resources. Our intention is to build relationships, cultivate and develop social and collective power, promote knowledge of self and history, and build economic interdependence and independence and generational wealth. Liberation and education and promoting knowledge of self and history is embedded in the pillars and mission of Columbia Community Care, and this morning, some of you were able to experience that in action. This morning, in his pre-conference workshop, our keynote speaker for this evening, Mr. Dante King, asked us to jot down a few questions that I think are so crucial to the critical thinking and understanding of the truth and reality of this country's history. Those questions were: what is legality? Who is responsible for creating it? Who is responsible for maintaining it? And what have I personally signed on to by accepting a white American legal system that serves to criminalize and abuse non-white people and most severely black people? I implore you to ponder those questions, those same questions, as you listen to the keynote tonight. Today, Dante showed us examples of law after law after law, each beginning with the words, "whereas some doubts have arisen," meaning, oops, we may have allowed a smidge of progress for black people in the last law, so now we must change it again, that has maintained and perpetuated 400 years of deep systemic and institutional anti-black racism, harm and oppression, and intentional government-maintained poverty for over 400 years and continues today. The law has just been a mechanism and tool used explicitly for the attempted spiritual, mental, emotional, and physical murder of black people. Whiteness is the inherent ability to live life with ease, while being black in this country is to never be at rest. I had the honor and privilege of experiencing the brilliance of Dante King for the first time this past summer in his session at a conference on racial and social justice, and I left deeply impacted and absolutely determined to bring him to Howard County, as his voice and knowledge is so desperately needed in our county. And just like that session, today's was just as raw, emotional, and real, actually more so. Dante King is a native of San Francisco, California. He holds a Bachelor of Arts degree in African American Studies and a Master's degree in Education from California State University, East Bay. He also possesses a Human Resources Management certificate. Dante has begun doctoral work in the area of educational leadership and social justice, with main focuses in challenging white supremacy and anti-blackness and their cumulative impacts on black people. He is the author of the new book, The 400-Year Holocaust: White America's Legal, Psychopathic and Sociopathic Black Genocide and the Revolt Against Critical Race Theory, which you should all purchase, which are on the back table. Dante is also a professor of American history, African American history, and Black studies. Dante currently serves as guest faculty at the University of California, San Francisco School of Medicine, UCSF, as well as the Mayo Clinic. Dante is a historian, scholar, public motivational speaker, thought leader, facilitator, and coach, and has worked and consulted for more than 15 years as a human resource management professional specializing in the implementation of anti-racist practice and organizational development and change. He has presented at numerous annual conferences and has been featured on a variety of media outlets, including Legal Lens with Angela Reddick White, Intentional Conversations with Dr. Nico White, and a host of others, amongst an array of many awards and recognition. Most recently, in spring of summer of 2022, Dante was awarded first place by the BookFest Awards in the genre of nonfiction history for penning the 400-year Holocaust. Dante also received the Dr. Huey P. Newton Trailblazer and Legacy Award, presented by BH Brilliant Minds Incorporated. And as I said this morning, that, my friends, is not even a quarter of his bio. It is my honor and privilege to introduce to you, as tonight's keynote speaker, Mr. Dante King.
All right. How is everyone? Pretty good? Good. So I'm going to start actually with a video, and I am going to try and make this as engaging as possible. How many of you have been to keynotes before and you're sitting there and by the eighth minute, you just zone out? Right? Okay. So I'm not going to do that. I'm going to do something a bit different. But first I want to say thank you very much, Erica, for your strength, for your leadership, for the support that you put behind this work, and just the work of activism overall, and how you show up for Black and brown people. I also want to thank Jackie for hosting me and for making sure that I got here and got here safely and well accommodated. And the team, yes. And the team at Howard County, I really am humbled and honored to be here. And so I'm a firm believer of amplifying the historical context of this country and really shedding a light to bring attention to the experiences that we all see before us today and that we all witnessed and have a lack of, and yet have a lack of context for. And so I am, what my work strives to do, what I strive to do in my work is to bring visibility and attention to how we got here. Has anyone ever wondered or pondered how we've gotten here outside of what you've learned in the white educational and academic system? By show of hands? Okay. So we're going to explore some nuances of that. Most of us, many of us know some of the pieces of the history that I'm going to lift up tonight, but I'm going to frame it in a particular way.
With the end of Reconstruction, the nature of both crime and punishment in the South changed dramatically. State after state, and county after county, new laws targeted African Americans and effectively criminalized Black life.
It was a crime in the South for a farm worker to walk beside a railroad. It was a crime in the South to speak loudly in the company of white women. It was a crime to sell the products of your farm after dark.
Anything from spitting or drinking or being found to be drunk in public or loitering in public spaces could result in confinement. So there was an over-exaggeration of African-American criminality during this time period. It's not to absolve all prisoners from having committed crimes, but there were many trumped up charges.
One of the most infamous set of laws to come out of this period were the pig laws, passed in Mississippi, Georgia, Florida, Alabama, enhancing penalties for what had been previously misdemeanor offenses to now felony offenses.
In Mississippi, theft of a pig worth as little as a dog could mean 5 years in prison. In Tennessee, hard labor might result from stealing an 8-cent fence rail.
But the most powerful, the most damaging of all of these laws were the vagrancy statutes. In every southern state, you became a criminal if you could not prove at any given moment that you were employed.
And I just want to pause and clarify something. You had to be able to prove that you were employed in employment that whites recognized as employment.
Under slavery, most black crime was punished by slaveholders, leaving the courts to discipline whites. Now, only about 10% of those arrested were white.
Now, what does this mean? Does this mean that white people are not committing crimes in the South? We know that's not true.
Southern states had a history of placing prisoners with industries that would bear the cost of guarding and housing in exchange for their labor. Now states also began to charge fees, renting prisoners to companies by the month. The highest rates were for the strongest workers and longest sentences. When you go to the 13th Amendment, one of the fascinating things about the text of that amendment is that it says that slavery is abolished, except in the case of a punishment for a crime. And within that wiggle room, what you see in it is that there's still the possibility of extending slavery, as it were, by another name.
It took time for the system of convict leasing to develop. It took time for the state to realize that prisoners, believe it or not, could be a source of profit. Once that revenue starts coming in, they're pleasantly surprised. This is new revenue we never had before.
The state of Alabama earned $14,000 in its first year of convict leasing, 1874. By 1890, revenue was $164,000, roughly $4.1 million today. By then, states throughout the South and hundreds of counties and cities were engaged in some form of leasing convicts to private industry.
And it gave tremendous discretionary power for the private owner, either a landowner or a corporation or a coal mine, could be any business concern, to do what they wanted with that African American.
All right, so I'm gonna have you now share with the person next to you what you took away from that particular excerpt in that video. And then I'm going to actually share some additional examples. But what registered for you once, and this is 1874, right after Reconstruction. So this is when Black people were supposedly emancipated and freed from enslavement. I'll give you 2 minutes, 1 minute each. Okay, if you hear my voice, go ahead and clap once. Okay, so, and we don't have a mic, I don't think, but Who would like to just share your their interpretation of what you just saw and heard from the video? Yeah. How many of you saw that? Okay. And it's systematic. Any others? Any other interpretations? Absolutely. Absolutely. That is, I agree with that. Did you all hear what she said? It feels like we're on a treadmill going absolutely nowhere. Yes. How many of you caught the dynamic of the changing of the laws? So you can't look white people in the eye. You've got to step off the sidewalk. You can't speak loudly in the company of white women. You can be arrested for any range of things. And so it's this never-ending cycle of white domination and control. Someone else had their hand raised. Absolutely. And so one of the things I just want to point out is that when you come from this orientation of legalized, legally facilitated terrorism, anything can seem like progress. Do you all understand that? Okay. He says Maryland leads the nation. Wow. So I'm going to layer this just a little bit and invite you to meet with others in the room and to discuss some of the things that I'm going to share with you. I won't be before you long. So anti-blackness is a white American legal, social, cultural, economic, institutional value and belief system. It involves... Turn to your neighbor and say, it involves the deprioritization of humans labeled as black people, as well as the criminalization, hypernegativity, hyperscrutiny, and negative positioning of black people and or blackness throughout all aspects of American society and life. If you agree with this definition, I'm going to ask you to stand where you are. I love how the black people didn't give it a second thought. Yep, that's it. That's it. All right, so you can have a seat. So as Americans, we are socialized and trained with innate psychological and emotional reflexes and impulses that react negatively. We're programmed with these impulses and reflexes where we react negatively to black people, especially black people who do not conform to and or emulate whiteness, okay? So I did a whole one-day training today, and if you missed it, that's okay, because I offer virtual courses, and I teach a two-day course that's available through the University of California, San Francisco, and it's online. So if anyone is wondering why I am so candid and direct in my language, please join me. So I want to share... As those state laws were changing, you also had this contention that was also occurring at the federal level. And so in May 1870, you have Congress pass the Enforcement Act of 1870, which actually was the first anti-terrorism law to hit the books on the federal level. It targeted groups such as the KKK, the Red Shirts, white supremacist groups that were going after black people. And you had this whole array, this whole landscape of black attorneys, judges, black people who were provided the opportunity to sit on juries. And they began to criminalize white men who were participating in these terrorist acts. And so, to make a long story short, in 1876, due to the Colfax massacre, in Louisiana, the U.S. Supreme Court decided that the 14th Amendment was not designed to protect individuals against the actions of other individuals. And so they overruled the Force Act of the Enforcement Acts of 1870. So the court overturned the convictions of whites who were charged with conspiring to deprive blacks of their constitutional rights, including the right to vote, and ruled that the Force Act of 1870 unconstitutional. So what impact does that have on white? What's the message to white people? I want you to answer that question with your neighbor at your table. What's the message? All right, who wants to answer that? What's the message? What'd you say? That white people are sovereign, that they are above the law, and they can do and get away with anything because they are protected by it. So even the most terroristic, villainous acts, it's a culture where the behaviors and the actions are unchecked. So think about that, and I want you to breathe that in. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, they're literally able to get away with murder. Okay, so in 1875, John Langston Mercer, who is an educator, civil rights activist, abolitionist, and founder of Howard Law School, he co-authors the Civil Rights Act of 1875 with Charles Sumner. And in this act provided or was designed to protect all citizens in their civil and legal rights, giving them treatment in public accommodations, transportation, and to prohibit exclusion from jury service. Because what do you think was happening? Right? So the 1866 Civil Rights Act, it wasn't working. The 14th and 15th Amendment, the laws weren't being followed. They weren't being enforced. And so we followed up with more legislation to try and address these systems in culture and nature of anti-blackness that is just continuing throughout the South. Okay? And so what happens? In 1883, you've got a conservative court that comes along and they rule the 1875 Act unconstitutional. And here's what they say. So in his majority opinion in the civil rights cases, and there were five that were on the docket, Associate Justice Joseph P. Bradley struck down the Civil Rights Act of 1875, holding that the 13th Amendment merely abolishes slavery and that the 14th Amendment did not give Congress the power to outlaw private acts of racial discrimination. So I want you to stand up and go and meet with someone from another table and share the impacts of this. What's the message to black people from the highest court in the land? Stand up. All right, if you hear my voice, go ahead and clap once. If you hear my voice, clap twice. Okay, one person, what's the message to black people? Go ahead. Your lives don't matter. How many of you can see that reality? It's in everything. Okay, thank your partner. You can have a seat. So the cases against Stanley and Nichols were indictments for denying black people the accommodations of an inn or hotel Ryan was charged with refusing a black person a seat at McGuire's Theater in San Francisco, and Singleton denied a person whose color was not given to the use of accommodations at the Grand Opera House in New York. The case of Robinson and Wife against the Memphis and Charleston Railroad Company was an action to recover $500 given by the second section of the 1875 Act. The grievance was the refusal by the railroad conductor to allow the wife to ride in the ladies' car because of her African descent. And so how many of you understand that with all of these legal precedents, these actions that are being taken by the highest court in the land, there is a relegation into a permanent underclass? How many of you get that? And anyone who integrates into this culture, not just white people, but Asians, Middle Eastern, the Japanese, Hispanics, they get to mistreat, denigrate, and degrade black people. Irish people, Jewish people, Italian people who were once relegated into underclasses, once they are inducted into the white organization, they get to benefit from the benefits that that organization provides. How many of you understand that whiteness is an organization formed for legal and political purposes? Okay? So Pace v. Alabama, in November 1881, a jury in Clark County, Alabama, convicted Tony Pace, a black man, and Mary Cox, a white woman, under Section 4189 of the Alabama Code, which criminalized fornication and adultery between persons of different races and outlawed interracial marriage. Mr. Pace and Ms. Cox were sentenced to 2 years in prison. On January 29, 1883, in Pace v. Alabama, the U.S. Supreme Court unanimously upheld their convictions, reasoning that the anti-miscegenation statute was not discriminatory and did not violate the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment because the penalty applied equally to each member of the interracial couple. Pace failed to overturn the reasoning. Genocidal, sociopathic, psychopathic reasoning. Pace failed to overturn the reasoning of the Alabama Supreme Court, which had held that fornication between persons of different races was exceptionally evil because it could result in the amalgamation of the two races, producing a mongrel population and a degraded civilization, the prevention of which is dictated by a sound public policy affecting the highest interests of society and government. So this is your Supreme Court. So why would anyone be surprised at the repeal of Roe v. Wade? The only people who would be surprised by that are people who haven't studied what this court is capable of doing, who are absent and bankrupt of knowledge of the historical realities. So then we get to the Ku Klux Klan Act, which was also enacted after the Act of 1870, and this is 1871. They were acted right along with each other. This one authorized the president at the time, Ulysses Grant, to use federal troops and use emergency measures to protect black people from groups like the KKK, the Red Shirts, and so on. And so forth. So, I talked about Cruikshank saying that essentially blacks could not be protected from terrorism. And in 1883, they said, you know, we forgot about that one act that was passed in 1871. And so here's what happened. On January 22nd, 1883, the US Supreme Court in the United States v. Harris dismissed indictments against a Tennessee sheriff and his accomplices accused of attacking four black men and killing one. The court held that the Force Act of 1871, a federal law passed to protect black Americans from violent terrorism, was unconstitutional because the 14th Amendment limited Congress to taking remedial steps against state action that violated the 14th Amendment and applied only to acts by states, not to acts of individuals. So go ahead and share amongst your tables. Just stay seated. And I want you to begin to share your thoughts about this. Because again, The video that I showed demonstrated clips of laws that began to be enacted and enforced state by state. This is coming from one of the highest branches of our government. So go ahead and share a quick reaction to this, and I'm going to move on. All right, so now that we have that underway, I'm actually, if you hear my voice, go ahead and clap once. If you hear my voice, clap twice. If you're still talking, stop. No. All right, so I'm going to actually layer this a bit more, because now that you have some context for what began to prevail during this period, because how many of you have heard, wow, there's a lot of lynching that began to happen during this period between 1880 and the mid 20th century? Well, it was facilitated by the Supreme Court of the United States, who outlawed anti-terrorism laws. How many of you understand that? That is essentially what happened. Okay, so I'm going to share this video, and it'll give a bit more detail, and then I have some additional slides that I'm going to share.
For a black man or woman standing up for equal justice in 1892 was taking a serious risk. On the night of March 9th, when Wells was out of town, her friend Tom Moss and two others were jailed for defending themselves against several white men who had attacked Moss's grocery store. Mass vigilantes dragged Moss and his two friends from their cells to a deserted railroad yard. Before he died, Moss cried out, "Tell my people to flee. There is no justice here." This lynching, a term that came to be applied to any mob killing of blacks, disheartened Wells.
When she had come back to Memphis, she saw that the community was absolutely devastated, and so was she. No one knew quite what to do. But when she read those words, she said, this is going to be her mission as well. And she begins to talk, begins to tell black Memphians, there is no justice for you here. The system is not working for us. No one is trying to get these killers of our young men. And it is one we should go.
And go they did. At least 6,000 black Memphis residents would heed Wells' call to leave. It was the beginning of an exodus that in the coming decades would number in the millions. The murder of her friend also opened her eyes to who the true targets of the lynch mob were.
When her three friends were lynched, she began to realize that even black, deep middle class black people could be victims of that. And she talks about how until that happened, she had believed that those excesses, what she called excesses against the race, were only directed against those people who had perhaps done something to deserve it.
This opened my eyes to what lynching really was, an excuse to get rid of Negroes who were acquiring wealth and property, and thus keep the race sterilized and keep the niggers down.
Ida Wells is one voice that says that these assumptions of black people, that we can actually come to some negotiated settlement with whites in this period, is a false assumption, and that you have to fight. But the only way you're going to do it is to fight.
Ida B. Wells would eventually leave Memphis for Chicago. There she began her crusade against the murder of Southern blacks, which she would continue for the rest of her life. But across the South, lynching continued. Edward White, Vance McClure, Link Wagner, Robert Williams, George King, Scott Sherman, John Fry, Oliver Belzer, William Smith, Thalagan Francis, A.L. Smart, Mr. and Mrs. Morris, Patrick Morris, Gilbert Francis, Vernon Love, Isaac Kaiser, Louis Senegal, Joseph Dizel, Frank James, Louis Mund, Hiram Whiteman, Tisano Lozano, Angelo Orgoso.
The tragedy today, I think, is a lot of people think they just hung somebody, but a ritualized lynching was a part of the culture of the South with even religious and patriotic connotations. Think about this. Some white folk, if they had the time, dressed up in their old army garb, their old army uniform, to come out to a lynching. Racism reached the point, it was so dramatized and so ritualized and codified in the laws and in the practices that it was the most normal, patriotic, and most religious thing that you could do is to worship segregation.
And so what does this mean about what it means to be white in the land of the free? I want you to answer that and talk about it within and amongst yourselves at your tables, and I'll give you a few minutes to do so.
Thank you.
All right, if you hear my voice, go ahead and clap once. All right, so I'm going to continue this, and I want to share some information, some additional information with you. So this is the lynching of L.D. Nelson, who was 14, and his mother, Laura Nelson, who attempted to protect her son. And I want you to notice right down underneath, you can see it in both of the pictures, in the right-hand corner of LD's photo, there's a C. And at the bottom of Laura's photo, it says copyright. These are postcards that were sold throughout this country in convenience stores, airports, gas stations. And these are the perpetrators posing for a picture. And so I pose several questions in my book, and I will get to them. But one is, how is this not seen as psychopathic or sociopathic? Jesse Washington, 1916. Vernon Jarrett, he said that people would go and dress up. They'd go home and put on their army garb. You've got county and city officials who would facilitate. With this one, they lit a bonfire, and every time he would catch on fire, they would raise him up so that he could agonize more. But this is important to understand, because this is happening due to a socialization and an inbred psychology. It's a nature that allows for people to become so emotionally bankrupt and void of humanity that they're able to participate in acts such as this. And there's a larger community that's saying, well, what did he do to deserve it? And that's part of the depravity and diabolical nature also. So we have to be conscious of that and mindful of it. This is the barbecue we had last night. My picture is to the left with the cross over it. Your son, Joe. John and Charles Ruggles, Redding, California, 1892. Clyde Johnson, 1935, the Eureka, Sacramento, California area. 3,000 will burn Negro. Not did. Will. Because he dated a white woman. And so he actually left and escaped, and he came back and got a job, was working at a hotel, and they found out that he was back in town, and we have to get him. And I want you to zoom in on this. John Hartfield will be lynched by Ellisville mob at 5 o'clock this afternoon. Governor Bilbo says he is powerless to prevent it. Thousands of people are flocking into Ellisville to attend the powerless to their hands and powerless to prevent it. Where is protection? Where can protection be found? Answer that question with the person next to you. And so white people are living in a delusional nature that we live in a fair and objective society. Functioning that way. The language of these laws have just changed, but the intent and the selective enforcement is still there. How many of you understand that? Okay. So, and we wonder many times, how did this evolve? How did this happen? It happened because it was facilitated by the highest court in the land. Are the faces on the white people in these photos who have their children present coming to a cultural event that is a rite of passage for the community? Although some whites found lynching unacceptable and barbaric, few of the perpetrators were ever brought to trial. Townspeople closed ranks to protect their own kind, thereby becoming partners in the crimes committed. Eyewitnesses refused to testify, and grand juries refused to bring indictments against easily identifiable mob participants because they're from a good family. They're prominent, upstanding citizens, Christian, good people. Prison is not the right choice for them. Even if they had, juries would have refused to convict, whatever the evidence. So Lynch Shaw, who was a 46-year-old successful businessman in 1936, he was too successful for his own good. And so Dr. Caretha Mitchell and her work around Know Your Place aggression, she talks about how you just cannot get too big in this culture. You will always be brought down to size. And so I need for us to understand that, because we play this game of fairness and equality and inclusivity and all things are better. And yet when I enter a meeting with my white colleagues and I say something, that the same person follows me up and they say it 2 minutes after me. They can't hear me when I say it, but they can hear them. And if I complain about it, they will potentially and have had me ejected from my position. They launched the anti-Dante campaign. Who does he think he is, right? And so there's an illusion, a delusion of fairness. We're not fair because white supremacy and whiteness has an agency and a power that is infinite and everlasting, and it can be activated within an instant. How many of you understand that? Okay. Whose son is this? Grandfather, great-grandfather. This is where they lynched a Negro the other day. They don't know who done it. I guess they don't care much. I don't. Do you? In the vast majority of reported lynchings, the courts, coroners, juries, or other official bodies chosen to investigate the murders concluded routinely that black victims had met their deaths at the hands of unknown parties, at the hands of persons unknown, or by persons unknown to the jury. So if you're brought up on charges and yet the people who are on the jury are not convicting you, this is called legalized murder. Do you understand that? Okay. Not only did distinguished public officials at all levels of government hesitate to condemn lynching, but some also chose to participate in lynch mobs. William Van Amberg, U.S. Senator from Mississippi. I led the mob which lynched Nels Patton, and I am proud of it. I directed every moment of the mob, and I did everything I could to see that he was lynched. Cole Blease, governor of South Carolina. I would have gladly resigned as governor rather than use my power of office to deter whites from punishing that nigger brute. If necessary, I would have come to Honey Path and led the mob. Theodore Bilbo, Mississippi governor, I call on every red-blooded white man to use any means to keep the niggers away from the polls. The photographs stretch our credulity, even numb our minds and senses to the full extent of the horror, but they must be examined if we are to understand how normal men and women could live with, participate in, and defend such atrocities, even reinterpret them so they would not see themselves or be perceived as less than civilized. The men and women who tortured, dismembered, and murdered in this fashion understood perfectly well what they were doing and thought of themselves as perfectly normal human beings. Few had any ethical qualms about their actions. This was not the outburst of crazed men or uncontrolled barbarians, but the triumph of a belief system that defined one people as less human than another. For the men and women who comprise these mobs, as for those who remain silent or indifferent, different or who provided the scientific scholarly explanations, this was the highest idealism in the service of their race, in preservation of their heritage. One has only to view the self-satisfied expressions on their faces as they posed beneath black people hanging from a rope or next to the charred remains of a Negro who had been burned to death. What is most disturbing about these scenes is the discovery that the perpetrators of these crimes were ordinary people, not so different from ourselves, merchants, farmers, laborers, machine operators, teachers, lawyers, doctors, policemen, students. They were family men and women, good, decent, church-going folk who came to believe that keeping black people in their place was nothing less than pest control, a way of combating an epidemic or virus that, if not checked, would be detrimental to the health and security of the community. So I want you to stand where you are, and I want you to go and locate another person that you haven't connected with and share your reaction to what I've just shared with you. All right, if you hear my voice, go ahead and clap once. If you hear my voice, clap twice. If you hear my voice, clap three times. All right, anyone want to share one takeaway? Very quickly, because I'm about to wrap up. Anyone want to share a takeaway? No one? All right, you can go back to your seats. Oh, you want to say something, Samaya? Oh, wait, 1 second. All right, so Samaya's going to share. And legally facilitate it. Yeah, that's the part that gets left out. Thank you so much. All right, so as I wrap up, I just want to share a few of the things that I frame in my book. So whiteness is a political organization created and structured for the purposes of power, supremacy, domination, exclusion, and oppression through legal, social, cultural, psychic, emotional, economic, and all other institutional power and control mechanisms. It encompasses the vilification and villainizing of people considered non-white and most severely humans labeled as black people and or African American. And so again, in what ways, and this is one of the questions that's central to my work, in what ways do these legal, socio, and psychosocial conditions shape white culture and white people's relationships with and attitudes towards black people? And this is central to understanding how the cultural landscape is created and allows other people who are not identified as white to villainize, dehumanize, degrade black people in this culture because it's part of the cultural identity. America does not work without anti-blackness. And so Dr. Alvin Poussin, he says, I think we have to establish that white racism is a mental illness. Many white social scientists would like to define racism as something that is normal, as a cultural variant. As long as we approach it that way, we really don't deal with the pathology of racism itself. It's like saying that cancer, because a lot of people have it in this society, is somehow normal. Dr. Bobby Wright, in his work around the psychopathic racial personality, he says, in their relationship with the black race, whites are psychopaths, and their behavior represents an underlying biologically transmitted proclivity with roots deep in their evolutionary history. The psychopath is an individual who is constantly in conflict with other persons or groups. He is unable to experience guilt, is completely selfish and callous, and has a total disregard for the rights of others. One of the best methods that can be used to measure the psychopathic traits of the white race is observing and analyzing their universal overt behaviors and attitudes towards blacks. Psychopaths simply ignore the concept of right and wrong. By ignoring this trait in the white race, the lack of ethical and moral development, blacks have made and are still making a tragic mistake basing the worldwide black liberation movement on moral suasion. It is pathological for blacks to keep attempting to use moral suasion on a people who have no morality, where race is the variable. Dr. Randy Borm from the Department of Mental Health Law and Policy from the University of South Florida, he says the transition into becoming a terrorist is rarely sudden and abrupt. What we know of actual terrorists suggests that there is rarely a conscious decision made to become a terrorist. Most involvement in terrorism results from gradual exposure and socialization towards extreme behavior. And so I'm going to close with this video. It is a song by Lauryn Hill called Black Rage. And someone took this song and put some imagery to it. And when I saw it some years ago now, I said, wow. It just really encompasses and summarizes the work that I'm doing. So I want you to sit back and listen and watch. And this will be my closing.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dante. Thank you. Dante has spent the day with us. And he has provided us with such important data and a foundation for us to really think about what it means for us to really make progress. Tomorrow we have a day full of wonderful speakers and presenters that are going to come to you from the perspective of the work that we do here in the community every day. No matter what it is, though, we want you to have the foundation and understand that there is trauma. There are existing systems rooted in history, rooted in laws that were created, that are supported by existing structures that still exist and in our present day are being rebuilt in front of our eyes. And the purpose of this conference from the very beginning was to provide people with the opportunity to come together across sectors, across disciplines, across the lifespan, and understand that we as individuals in the Howard County community, in this region, in Maryland, and wherever it may take you from here, we each have the power, we each have the opportunity, and dare I say, we each have the obligation to be a champion for change, for the better, for all of humanity. And yet we can't forget that there are many people who are suffering every day in trauma. And as we do our work and we see the little ones in that video, I am so happy to say that part of our work diligently every day on behalf of the Office of Children and Families is with our most important folks, I think, in this community, those who are with our children every day, our childcare community, our educators, folks who have the opportunity to pour into our children and help the families navigate systems and structures that can change their lens at which they view not only themselves, but others and people in the community and our community. So when we're engaged in those discussions tomorrow, think about what you can do as a childcare provider, as a business owner, as an educator, as a teacher, to change that system. Our social workers, our lawyers, our business folks, our administrators, all the policy folks that will be in the room and be joining us, we all have a role to play. And I'm excited to be a part of the convening and thankful to our partners, the library system and Columbia Community Care, for standing alongside us to make the courageous stand to say this is important, this difficult conversation, this data, all of these things that we're doing are important in our community, and we're going to ensure that we have the conversation. So tonight, enjoy, because there's going to be some more music here with our band as we kind of close up and people mingle, make connections. But most of all, when you go home, get some rest, think about what you've heard, and come back tomorrow morning energized and ready and continuing to be open to receive the kinds of information. We have some of our speakers here with us tonight. I'm so glad that you're here. We have other key partners. I want to give a shout out to my friend and colleague, Lakey Boy, from the Columbia Association, through whose dedication she jumped into this community and said, yes, this matters, equity matters, our community matters, and I'm gonna show up for it. So thank you, my friend, for being here. And so make use of this wonderful time. Thank you, Dante. Dante is going to be with us all day tomorrow. And so if you didn't get your book tonight, there'll probably be some left tomorrow to get them signed. And he'll be, you know, around and you can have conversations. Thank you all for your time tonight. I know you've had long days and you didn't have to show up tonight, but you did because this mattered to you and it was important. So thank you very much for doing it. Enjoy your time, your remaining time together as we kind of wind up this evening, and we have a little bit of music to play as we end out. Have a good evening, and I'll see you tomorrow morning. I think we're starting at about 8:15. I think the registration opens around 7:30. So between 7:30 and 8:15, get your bags, bring your stuff, get your coffee, your food, come ready. And I think we're going to start right on time because we have a full great day ahead. So have a good evening, everyone.